Okay, let's look at, that now that we've covered sort of the basics of exchange rates, what they really mean, how they can be expressed, and two types of exchange rate, spot and forward. Now let's look at how the exchange rate can be used in other sort of international finance contexts. What do exchange rates imply about prices in two different countries? First, the price for the same commodity should be the same in the two countries. This is the sort of the definition of the so-called absolute purchasing power parity or absolute PPP. We will look at this first. Then, forward exchange rates are closely related to expected change in prices in the two countries. This is how the relative purchasing power parity or relative PPP is defined. Let's start with the absolute purchasing power parity, and then we will look at the relative purchasing power parity. What the two have in common, and there will be a formula for each, is that they connect the exchange rate with prices in different countries, in two different countries. Absolute purchasing power parity. The idea is that the same commodity costs the same in different countries. So let's say a cup of Starbucks coffee, right? Same size, same like coffee beans, same everything. It should, it makes sense for it to cost the same amount of money in the United States as well as in any foreign country, right? If you just, use the exchange rate. For example, a hamburger costs $2 in the USA. The exchange rate between the dollar and the Japanese yen is $1 equals 120 Japanese yen. How much should the same hamburger cost in Japan if the absolute purchasing power parity holds? In other words, if it's true that this hamburger costs the same amount of money in both countries. So the solution is if $1 gives us 120 yen, then $2, which is the cost of this burger, should give us the price for the same burger in Japan. So $2 times 120 yen per $1 equals 240 Japanese yen. So 240 Japanese yen is how much the same exact burger should cost in Japan. So it's a pretty simple topic, right? Now let's think about what this kind of simple looking topic is really all about. What if this burger does not cost 240 yen in Japan, but what if it costs, let's say, 300 yen? What does it mean? So it's cheaper in the US than it is in Japan. Whenever the price does not follow the absolute purchasing power parity, so when it's not what it should be based on the calculation like this, we say that there is an opportunity for you to make profit, or a so-called arbitrage opportunity, riskless profit, in other words. So how would you make profit in this case? Well, making profit means buy something cheap and selling it for more money. So you make profit on the price difference, right? Well, how can you make profit with the kind of the price differential for this burger in this problem? I always tell my students that, well, you start by taking two large suitcases, and then they start laughing because they know what's coming next. And yes, they're right. What I'm going to say next is you go to a local McDonald's in the United States, buy a whole bunch of burgers for $2 each, pack your two large suitcases with those burgers, then you fly to Japan and sell each burger for more money. So each burger, when sold in Japan, will give you some profit, And then your two suitcases full of burgers will give you a huge profit, right? Well, even though this is exactly how you would take advantage of this profit or arbitrage opportunity, kind of guaranteed profit, nobody would do anything stupid like this, right? First, because at the border in Japan, they will tell you, what's all that? They will want you to, you know, give them all the burgers and they will trash them. It's all a perishable product, right? It can go bad. Second, there are typically import like restrictions or limitations on how much of different stuff you can bring into the country. And on top of that, well, you have to pay for your flight to Japan, and that already kills your, at least partially, your potential profit, right? So there are all these different kind of restrictions in real life that don't allow for this kind of profit opportunities to be realized. Have you heard of the Big Mac Index? Actually, this is true. This is real. So if you go to this website, economist.com, you will find the explanation about the Big Mac Index. It's called Burgernomics. It's actually all real. It's not a joke. So if you scroll down, you will see, for example, a table here on the left. It has different country names: Switzerland, Norway, Sweden, United States, and so on. And then in the rightmost column in this table, it says under / overvalued by percent. In other words, people have researched the price for the Big Mac, how much it should cost in different countries in their local currencies, and compared that fair price with how much it actually costs in those countries. And they calculated this percentage, you know, difference in the between the actual price and what the price should be. So what's the best country to go to if you love Big Macs? Well, you'd wanna fly to the country where it's undervalued the most. So if you scroll down, you wanna find the country with the highest negative percentage. What is that country? That country is Russia. Russia is the winner, minus 70%. So in Russian currency, in rubles, you'll be paying only, you'll be paying 70% less to buy a Big Mac than how much technically you should be paying if it's priced fairly. So welcome to my home country. That's the price, that's the country with the cheapest Big Macs. Well, or you can go to Ukraine, which is right next door. Turkey is the third cheapest country to eat a delicious Big Macs. What's the worst country to go to if you like Big Macs? That's the country where it's overvalued the most, and that's Switzerland. Actually, this table shows three countries, only three countries, in which Big Macs are overpriced. Switzerland is number one, followed by Norway, 5%. Overvalued by 5%, and then Sweden overvalued by 4%. Okay, so now you know what this whole Big Mac Index is all about. Okay, but let's not spend any more time on it. It's not going to be covered on any of your exams. It's just for general knowledge. Let's do another example on the absolute purchasing power parity, or how much something should cost if it's priced right. Let's say we have a commodity, which is a laptop produced by Dell, a Dell laptop. It costs $1,500 in the United States of America. The same exact laptop costs 1,100 euros in France. What should the exchange rate between the dollar and the euro be if the absolute purchasing power parity holds? This means If the laptop costs exactly, you know, what it should, then what's the exchange rate? So the exchange rate is, and remember how we can express it two different ways. If you want to express it in terms of dollars per 1 euro, then where we now have 1100 euros, we would need to divide it by 1100. So we are left with 1 euro. And we also divide by 1100 the amount of dollars, $1,500. So when $1,500 is divided by 1100, we get $1.36 per 1 euro. If you instead want to express the exchange rate the other way around, how many euros it is per $1, then you divide both $1,500 and 1100 euros by 1500, which is how you would be left with $1. So $1,100 divided by 1500 gives 0.73 of a euro per $1. So the exchange rate that implies that the absolute purchasing power parity holds, or no arbitrage opportunity in other words, is $1.36 per euro, or 0.73 of a euro per $1. Let's summarize the absolute purchasing power parity formula that we used in the last few examples. The price in a foreign country, P subscript FC, expressed in terms of the foreign country's currency, such as, let's say, the price for a burger, 240 yen, the example we had, is equal to the exchange rate, or to be precise, the spot exchange rate, S subscript 0, expressed in the amount of foreign currency per $1, such as, for example, 120 yen per $1, multiplied by the price in the United States, P subscript USA. So that's the price in the USA in the local currency, in the US dollars, such as, for example, $2 for as the price for the local Big Mac. So price foreign country equals the exchange rate today, the spot exchange rate, multiplied by the price in the United States. And the important thing is the exchange rate is expressed as how many units of foreign country's currency you get with one US dollar. If it was the other expression, then in this formula, we would have price USA divided by current spot exchange rate. So this absolute purchasing power parity holds if transaction costs are zero. So for example, in my example I gave you earlier with buying Big Macs for cheap in the US, fly to Japan to sell them for more money over there, that the transaction costs equal to zero would mean it's free to get on the plane and fly to Japan. But in real life, there is no such free, you know, thing. Then no barriers to trade, such as no taxes, no tariff taxes, no like restrictions on how much stuff you can bring in from one country to another. And also no difference in the commodity between locations. For example, this kind of means that this the same commodity has the same economic value in both countries. So for example, in like what's valuable in the US might have almost no value or not been used at all in other countries. Like mentioned earlier, even if you, the absolute purchasing power parity rarely holds in practice, which means we rarely see that the price of some commodity in some country is exactly what it should be. So it's actually typically not true. It's not what it should be. But even though we have this kind of profit opportunity, all these restrictions, transaction costs, barriers to trade, difference in the commodity value between different countries. All of these different issues result in you not being able to take advantage of these profit opportunities.